morning, Triangle Grace Church, wherever you are. I'm glad that you've decided to join us once again this morning for our live broadcast here from the sanctuary. Just to let you know who's helping us this week. Of course, Nikki's still on the camera. We have Sydney Simpson Voss going to be singing later on. Julie Hoffer is going to be helping with the hymns. Letta, of course, is going to be providing the music for all of that. And Dennis Style is up on the soundboard for us, so I thank them for their willingness to come out and be a part of this service. And we're especially grateful that you're here with us as well, and pray that this will be an opportunity for all of us to enter into a meaningful time of worship as we look around and we're able to see the familiar surroundings of worship, even if you're not able to be physically present with us today. Well, the saga continues, and so we'll continue to have these live stream worship experiences as long as necessary. We hope that that's not too long, but we know that we haven't yet peaked with this virus, and so we will continue to pray that that happens quickly and folks get well, and that we're able to be able to join together again in the not too too distant future. Although our facilities are closed for meetings during the week, we are continuing to leave the front door open during the office hours of 8 and 4, Monday through Friday, so that you can continue to drop off food for our brothers and sisters across town with the Hispanic ministry that we support and their food shelter. We've created a station right inside the door, so you don't have to talk with anyone, you don't have to touch anyone, you can just bring in your donations and leave them there, and we're grateful. You guys have done a great job, by the way. We loaded up their car the other day, and we've got enough to load their car again as of this morning. So we're going to be calling them to say, come and get it so that they can distribute it. Probably, I think it's on Tuesday when they actually do that distribution. Well, let's worship this morning. Hear these words from the psalmist. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend his works to another. They will tell of his mighty acts. We will speak of the glorious splendor of his majesty, and we will meditate on his wonderful works. We will tell of his power, of his awesome works. We will proclaim his great deeds. We'll celebrate God's abundant goodness and joyfully sing of God's righteousness. So important in these trying days to remember that God is good all the time. And all the time God is good. And we can celebrate God's goodness and we can sing to God joyfully for all that he has done and continues to do for us. Let's pray together. Father, we're grateful for the opportunity to gather across this county and in other places, even in other places in the world, to worship you this morning. We're grateful for the technology that makes that possible. We're especially grateful this morning, Lord, that your promise is that you are with us wherever we are. And so we claim that promise today. In the name of Jesus, we pray that we would have the sure sense of your presence with us. And all this we pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. I hope that you printed off your worship resources this week. We're going to begin with a great hymn of faith and praise. Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Wherever you are, join in as we sing.
Oh, my soul, praise.
now use those ancient words which have been spoken by people throughout the ages, congregations gathered in worship who affirm their faith. Let's use the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It's almost time for us to go into a time of prayer, but before we do that, I want to say a special word to our youngest worshipers today. So moms and dads, if your kids are kind of in other places, draw them around the screen so that I can talk directly with them for just a moment. To you young people, did you know that you are experiencing something that I never experienced when I was your age? I never had my school canceled for this long period of time. I never went through long times when I couldn't play with my friends, at least up close. I never went through a time when my parents couldn't go to work, couldn't even leave the house at times. And as I thought about this, I wondered, what are you missing most in all of this time? What is it that you're missing more than anything else? Something tells me it may not be school. I know some of you are doing schoolwork at home. That's what we have to do. But I'm guessing that the thing that you're missing more than anything else is being able to be with your friends. Doing the things that you usually do. Playing baseball, playing basketball. Doing the stuff that you do in the yard and in the neighborhood. See, what we grown-ups would say is that you're missing relationships. I know that I am. I'm really missing your face. I wish that I could see you right now. I wish that you could come into my office and stop by the grace jar. Do you think that God ever misses us when we go for long periods of time without talking to him? See, he's given us this thing called prayer. And we're going to be talking about that this morning in the sermon. But prayer is really an invitation to come close to God. And his promise is that he always hears us, that he's always with us, and that he'll never leave us. So if this time is a little scary for you, it's scary for all of us. Just remember that you can talk to God about it anytime you want to. He's always there. He's always listening. And I think that it brings a smile to his face whenever you turn to him and just say, I need to talk with you about something. And that's what we're going to do right now. So let's all bow our heads together as we pray. Father, as we come to you today, we thank you for your promise that you are with us always. And we're grateful that even though we can't be together and worship together right now, that you hear us wherever we are. And through your Holy Spirit, you can knit our hearts together with your love. And we can even be aware that even though we're apart, we're your body together worshiping. As we continue to deal with the uncertainty of the world, we're thankful that we're certain of your love. We're certain of your care. We're certain that you're still watching out over your creation. And so we pray you would give us faith to navigate these unfamiliar waters of life. We're especially mindful today of those who are sick, for those who have been struck with this virus. But we pray as well for those who are worried because they've been told that they are the most vulnerable. We pray that you would give them faith and hope in you. As we ordinarily do, we pray for the homeless and the elderly, for those whose conditions are compromised. We pray that you would keep them safe from harm. We pray for those families that have been devastated because they've lost loved ones in this. We pray for those whose lives are at peril this morning. We pray that your healing grace and your comfort will be in those places where you're needed in these very special days. Especially today, we want to hold before you those whose conditions have almost been forgotten or at least minimized because they've been overshadowed by the effects of this virus. We pray for those who are healing from surgeries. We pray for those who are in rehab centers trying to get back on their feet. We pray for those who are going through cancer treatments and other serious conditions. We pray for those who recognize that they are perhaps in the last days of their lives. We pray that they would sense your presence and know that you care. Especially this week, we've heard of those affected by the economic impact of this. We pray for those who are worried about such things, for those who are even now out of work. And so we continue to pray for stressed out families and for those who are wondering where their next meal will come from. And we pray for our leaders that are called upon to make difficult decisions in these difficult days. We pray for your church. Give us a spirit of perseverance and the power to endure as we seek to reach out to a world in need with the good news of Jesus. And hear us now as we pray the words that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Endure.
Thank you, Sid. We need that kind of reminder. God's grace is amazing, and it continues to amaze us. Friends, let's turn to God's Word this morning. Look in your Bible at chapter 6 of Matthew's Gospel. Matthew chapter 6, we're going to be reading beginning at verse 5, and then we're going to shift over after we read a few verses there over to verse 7 as we come to this part of God's Word. Let's pray just for a moment. Gracious God, the one whose grace amazes us, we pray that once again, as you inspired this word to be written long ago, that you would inspire it to our hearts this day. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear, hearts that are open to the work that you're doing in us this moment. And all this we pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Matthew chapter 6, beginning with verse 5, says, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they can be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask. So pray like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Then in chapter 7, with verse 7, "Ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it is open. Or which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone, or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, who is in heaven, give good things to those who ask him?" Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. You know, after all these years, I don't think that I should be surprised when God brings things together in ways that I never could have actually planned them if I had been trying myself. Today is one of those days. These are some of those times. The small group studies that we have been going through in the congregation and the sermons associated with them, they were planned long, long ago. They were set in place. And yet it seems as if in many ways they were designed with our current circumstances, especially in mind. I didn't read the entire chapter of Matthew's Gospel this morning, but if I had, you would have seen that a bit later it contains that part where we hear from Jesus that we shouldn't be anxious about our lives. Make sure that at some point during today, you go and read the rest of that so that you can once again allow that word to come into your heart and into your life to hear those words, "Be not anxious about your life." Well, prayer, as we talked about in this text, as it's talked about, prayer is a popular exercise these days, isn't it? Have you noticed that people, even those who don't necessarily claim to be particularly religious, are talking about prayer? And in some cases, they're asking others to pray for them or asking us as a nation to enter into prayer. I've even heard that some people are saying the Lord's Prayer as they wash their hands. Apparently, it takes about 20 seconds to say the Lord's Prayer, and they're doing that not as a trivial sort of thing, but as a reminder that each time we do those sorts of routine tasks that we're being asked to do, that we remember God is with us and we can depend upon Him. There's a reason, I think, why prayer is so important. When we're not sure what to do, when we're scared, when we're anxious, when we're uncertain, we are wired to reach out beyond ourselves. When we feel like our lives are out of control, we look for some source, some assurance that someone is in control. And as followers of Jesus, we know who that someone is. Pastors and others have taken to social media to offer words of encouragement and words of comfort and words of assurance. One of the messages that I've heard over and over again, and I've been listening to a lot of my friends and others that I don't even know, but I'm hearing a word over and over again, and that word is this: God is still in control. There's nothing about our current situation that is outside the control of Almighty God. And God's character and God's attributes speak to and of His sovereignty. We may know that what's going to happen as this virus continues doing what it's doing, but we can be assured of this: even this virus is not outside the control of God. Even in this uncertain time, especially in this uncertain time, we need to trust God and recognize that God has given us the resources that we need. He's given us His power to walk through some of the difficult doors that we're going to find in front of us as these days and weeks progress. So today, as we finish up the sermon part of our church-wide study, as we continue thinking about walking through doors, we're going to talk about one of the resources that God gives us to take that next step. In connection with our study, I read this quote. I think it was from John Ortberg, although it wasn't directly attributed to him. But here it is: prayer is our power to walk through new doors, to overcome the fear of uncertainty. Open door prayer is intimacy with God to address the isolation life can bring. It is prayer for when the deep parts of us find the deep parts of God. So our focus this morning is going to be this great resource, this tremendous power that God has supplied to us that we call prayer. But before we go there, let me ask you a couple of questions that you can ponder wherever you are. Have you ever felt guilty because you don't feel like you spend enough time in prayer? Have you ever thought, I'm not really very good at praying because it seems like I just don't have the right words to say? Have you ever heard others talk about their prayer lives and thought, why can't I pray like him or her? To be truthful, I have at times thought and felt all of those things, and my guess is that maybe you have too. Through conversations with many believers through the years, one of the things that I have seen is, for those who take their discipleship very seriously, one of the things that they often talk about is the difficulty they have with their devotional and their prayer lives. We seem to have trouble gaining a sense of consistency. We have trouble establishing healthy patterns of scripture reading and prayer. That's one of the reasons why we do some of the things that we do here, like determine together we're going to read through the New Testament in the year. Even though we recognize that we feel better, we're less anxious, good things happen to us when we begin our days with scripture reading and prayer, sometimes we go for a day or maybe even days without doing those things. Well, if it makes you feel better, I'm not sure that the disciples of Jesus really got it at first when it comes to prayer. It's not recorded in Matthew's gospel, but if you turn over and read the part of Luke's gospel that records the Lord's Prayer, Jesus offers that prayer for them in response to a question by his disciples. The disciples ask him, "Lord, can you teach us to pray like John's disciples?" You know, I wonder if they were looking at John's disciples and they were saying, "Why can't we pray like those guys?" I wonder if, at least in part, our problem with prayer comes from a misconception concerning prayer, a misunderstanding about prayer. The late Lloyd Ogilvie, in one of his books, wrote this. He said, "I've been a Christian for 35 years. Far too many of those years were spent with a totally incorrect conception of prayer. I labored with the misapprehension that prayer was my idea, that conversation with God was initiated by me. That idea took on the heavy baggage of believing that I had to get God's attention and that he would listen and respond if I said the right words and led a life that was worthy of his condescension. Prayer became burdensome, laborious." We've talked about it often before, but once again this morning, let's see if we can get a handle, a better understanding of this resource that God has given us that's called prayer. Hopefully in doing so, what we'll see is that prayer gives us the power that we need to walk through the doors that God opens for us. Now, to start with, it would be, I think, remiss if I didn't point out that Jesus began by telling his disciples not how to pray, but how not to pray. He says, "Don't pray like the hypocrites." Then he tells us what that means. He warns against praying to be seen by others. He warns against heaping up phrases, empty phrases, he calls them, so that we can be heard by others. But what's Jesus doing? He's telling his disciples that they need to be authentic in their prayers. It's another way of just saying you need to be yourself when you pray. When it comes to prayer, we really are just talking to one person. You've probably heard me tell the story before about Bill Moyers, who was a special assistant to President Lyndon Johnson. Bill Moyers was asked to pray before a meal, and he began praying in a very soft tone. And in just a moment, President Johnson said, "Speak up, Bill, speak up." To which Mr. Moyers replied, "I wasn't addressing you, Mr. President." You know, even during our public prayers, we need to remember that there's still an audience of one. The reason why we pray aloud is simply so we can agree with one another concerning what we're praying about. So there's no need to change the way we talk as if a more advanced vocabulary or a deeper tone in our voice will somehow get God's attention. God is already with us. God already hears every word we speak in prayer and otherwise. So it comes down to this: prayer is far more about relationship and our understanding of our relationship with God than it is about the words we use or the inflection of our voice. Think about it this way. Prayer is an open invitation into the total awareness of the presence of God. Did you hear that? Prayer is an open invitation into the total awareness of the presence of God. Now understand what I'm saying here. We already are in the presence of God. He promised that he's with us always. But in prayer, we become more deeply aware of his presence. So prayer is about relationship. And Jesus makes it clear when he begins. the Lord's Prayer, or what we know as the Lord's Prayer, that it's about relationship because he begins with relational language. Now, I begin prayers in all kinds of different ways. You probably do as well. Sometimes I'll say Almighty God or Merciful Savior or Sovereign Lord. In this case, Jesus, when he's talking to his disciples about prayer, he begins by saying Our Father. I think Jesus did that for a reason. I think he wanted to emphasize the relational aspect of our faith. Father is a term of relationship. And for most of us, it's a term of deep endearment. In the part of chapter 7 that we read, we see that Jesus gave an example of prayer that emphasizes the fatherly nature of God's love. He said, "What father, if asked for a loaf of bread, would give his son a stone instead? Or if a child asked for a fish, who would give him a snake?" Well, we know the obvious answer to that. No parent would do that. That's just not what parents do. Jesus then went on to say, if sinful parents like us know how to give good gifts to our children, how much more will our Heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Could earthly parents ever outgive God? No way. So it's important when we pray to remember that the one to whom we pray, he knows us. He knows everything about us. He created this world with you in mind. He cares profoundly about you. He's lavished upon you his love and his mercy and his grace, and he's given you the beauty that you're able to see around you every single day. You experience that through the hand of your Heavenly Father. Even when those he created rebelled against him, God immediately began the long and difficult process of bringing them back into relationship with himself. And God continues to be in that process, bringing us back to himself. That's really the story of the whole Bible. It's about how God is seeking to draw us to himself. The world as we know it is not as God intended for it when he created it. We're in the midst of this global crisis that's being caused by a virus that can make people very sick. That virus is able to do what it is doing because of what went on in the garden in the rebellion of Adam and Eve. Before their sin cast a stain on the creation, before it cast that stain, it was paradise. But that paradise was marred by sin, and we still live with some of the effects of that sin, including things like viruses. But the good news in all of this is that God was still willing to do whatever it took to remove that stain. And so through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, his own son, God has taken care of our sin problem, and a day will come when we will see redemption complete in what the Bible talks about as the new heaven and new earth. That's why we can be assured that COVID-19, or any other virus for that matter, will never have the last word. God is doing his work of redemption. And God is even able to find ways to use this crisis for our good and for his glory. Now, sometimes we can't see that in the moment, but we can trust God to bring about all the things that he does through his redemption. So here's the thing. Our Heavenly Father desperately wants us to be in relationship with himself. He sent his own son to bring that about. And prayer is one of the gifts that he's given us to enhance that relationship. It's a source of help. It's a way in which God releases his power into our lives. But somehow, we sometimes take that gift and we turn it into a sense of guilt when it ought to be a source of gladness. I quoted John Lloyd Ogilvie earlier, and concerning his lackluster prayer life. Let me not leave him there, because later on in that same book he says this: "Then one day a few years ago, I happened on a combination of scriptures from the Old and New Testaments which exploded the tight, constricted, and limited prayer view that I had held. They all thundered forth a truth which I desperately needed to learn and live. Simply stated, it's this: prayer starts with God. It's His idea. The desire to pray is the result of God's greater desire to talk to us." So prayer is about relationship, and that relationship began at the initiative of Almighty God. God's intention was never to use prayer as a means to produce guilt. God's intention in prayer is to spend quality time with you and with me. And it's meant to give us the resources that we need to live this life. So prayer is meant to be relationship building, not guilt producing. I love Dallas Willard's definition of prayer. He said, "I believe the most adequate description of prayer is simply talking to God about what we're doing together." He also wrote, "The more we pray, the more we think to pray. And as we see the results of prayer, the responses of our Father to our requests, our confidence in God and His power spills over into other areas of our lives." That means it is through prayer that God gives us the power to walk through those doors. Recently, I shared with our congregation here what Tim Stafford wrote about prayer. He said, "Here, I believe, is the key to understanding what is most personal in prayer. We do not pray to tell God what He does not know, nor to remind Him of things He's forgotten. He already cares for the things we pray about. He's simply been waiting for us to care about them with Him." If prayer is about our relationship with God, could it be that there are even times that God allows circumstances in our lives that have the effect of driving us into His arms? Are we in one of those times now? Friends, God has not abandoned you. He's opened His arms to you. And being in God's presence shapes who you are and how you react to the experiences of life. Recently, before everything got shut down, Lindsay and her children came to our house for their spring break. In having my grandchildren around, I realized something that I experienced when they were just babies has not changed for me. I can remember holding them in my arms and loving them so much that my greatest desire was for them to know my love and to know me. I wanted them to experience the depth of my love. I wanted them to know that I would be there for them. If you're a grandparent, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Well, on this spring break, I invited each of the three grandchildren who were with us to spend some special time with me, as together we made a little stained glass project that they could take home. You know, that's one of my passions now, as I enjoy working with stained glass. And so they each got to choose a pattern, and then we spent time looking through all the glass that I have, and they could choose whatever colors they wanted to be as a part of their project. And then step by step together, we worked on their project. I made a rule when they came into my garage that no electronics are allowed in Granddad's garage. There were no distractions. We spent the time together, working and talking. Now, I will say that one of them admitted up front that she was fearful that she was going to get bored as we went along. You know, I've since wondered at that statement that she made, if that's sometimes what we think when we're going to God in prayer. Well, gee, maybe we'll get bored. Maybe we need to bring something with us to occupy our time. Well, when all was said and done, I think that all three of them would agree with me that it was a good day. It was a good day of relationship building. It was a good day of just spending quality time together. Do you understand that God wants you to work with Him on the projects He's doing in the world? He cares for the things that we care about. He's just been waiting for us to care about them with Him. And so what are we to pray? Well, the model prayer that Jesus gave is not particularly complicated. It begins with a recognition that God is God and we're not. It affirms that the world is not what it should be, and so it asks God to continue in that redemption process, bring your kingdom to earth as it is in heaven. It asks that the needs of our lives be met and recognizes that there are failures and shortcomings which need to be forgiven by God. It also admits that we live in a world that sometimes seeks to lead us astray. I think Jesus was saying that we need to pray from our hearts those things that are of concern for us. Nothing is off limits. We can bring God our joy. We can bring Him our disappointments. We can ask Him any question. In chapter 7, Jesus is still talking about prayer when He encourages us to ask and seek and knock. Because those who ask receive, those who seek find, and those who knock the door is opened. Those are the things that God invites you and me to do in prayer. Ask, seek, knock. John Ortberg makes the point that those are the things that beggars do. We ask, we seek, we knock. But here's what we know. Because we know that prayer is really about our relationship with God, prayer is not a way to get more from God. It's a way to get more of God. That's why we seek first God's kingdom, and all these other things are added to us as well. And this brings us to the realization when it comes to going through doors. That's what we've been talking about for weeks now. When it comes to going through doors, it really isn't what's on the other side of the door that we need. What we need is the one who opens the door. And prayer is the ultimate admission that we simply cannot do life alone. We need God. We need to be in a deeper, richer relationship with God. We need to know that we are loved by God, and we need to know that God is watching over every single aspect of our lives. Tim Keller says prayer is the way to experience a powerful confidence that God is handling our lives well, that our bad things will turn out for our good, and our good things cannot be taken from us, and the best things are yet to come. So I have an assignment for you today. Find a quiet place sometime this afternoon. Go there by yourself. Doesn't have to be for a long time, but it needs to be long enough for you to be able to share with God the deepest concern of your heart today. Are you struggling with fear or with anxiety? Are you worried about your job or your finances? Is there a relationship that you're concerned about? Is there a person in your life that you're really worried about? Whatever it is, find a quiet place. Go there by yourself and take it to the Lord. Now, He already knows about it, but you need to voice it to Him so that you can be assured that you're working on it with Him. And one of the things that I hope that you'll find in that process is that one of the byproducts of prayer is God's peace. You have a Father who loves you and who loves it every time you come to Him and you say, Father, I've got something I need to talk with you about. Let's pray. Too often our lives resonate with the words of that hymn, Lord. All the peace we often forfeit, all the needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to you, our Father, in prayer. Help us to understand in new ways that the invitation has been given and you are standing before us with arms wide open. We thank you for your love and for your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as we conclude our worship this morning, let's sing together that wonderful hymn that speaks about our closeness to God, near to the heart of God. Friends, let me tell you, you were never meant to handle this life on your own. So take the advice of the writer of Proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make straight your paths. Wherever you may be this day, may God grant you His peace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, the fellowship and communion of His Holy Spirit be with you, abide with you, uplift you, and empower you, both now and forevermore. Amen.